So by this point, I have fished hundreds, if not thousands of days on lakes, rivers, ponds, and streams everywhere across the country for those little pesky brown and green fish we like to call bass. And I've thrown virtually every single lure out there and have become pretty proficient at throwing all of them. But one of those that has kind of escaped my understanding for so many years until fairly recently has been the jerkbait. Now there are two sides of the jerkbait family. There's the soft jerkbait and the hard jerkbait. The soft, often referred to as the fluke, is one that I've been fishing for a long time, but the other side of the family, the hard jerkbaits, is something that I really haven't put a whole lot of time into until fairly recently, which is why today I'm going to be discussing why the jerkbait is one of the best all year round fishing techniques, but especially in that pre-spawn time when those bass are moving shallow, they want to feed up on a few last minute snacks before they head up on the bed to spawn. I'm going to talk about where to throw the jerkbait, how to throw the jerkbait, and of course show you guys a lot of cool fish catches at the end of this video using my jerkbait and getting a little bit of help from my electronics back there called LiveScope. As always, my name is Tally Anderson, welcome to TRF, and let's talk about it. How's it going, everybody, and welcome back to TRF. My goal on this channel that you're watching right now is to help you guys become better bass anglers. So if you're all about that, hit that subscribe button to join Team TRF because I want you guys to be along for the journey of learning here with us. Now, hopefully this video will encourage you guys to go out there and catch more fish for yourself. But if you have other questions about bass fishing topics, chances are I've made a video about it. If you go on YouTube and search Tyler's Reel Fishing, anything, jerkbaits, chatterbaits, pre-spawn, spawn, summertime, deep cranking, I've probably made a video on every single one of those, or I will in the very near future. So without further ado, let's jump into what is the jerkbait and what does it represent? The jerkbait is a minnow imitation lure that is designed to go back, forth, back, forth. It's designed to jerk in the water column, left, right, left, right. It's been used in both bass fishing, saltwater, crappie, basically any type of game fish love to eat a jerkbait. Now this here is my jerkbait box. It's got tons of different colors, sizes, and shapes of jerkbaits, but the majority of the exact shape of a jerkbait is a cylinder type lure with a bill on the front. So imagine if you never thrown a jerkbait before, but you thrown a crankbait. Imagine you take a crankbait and you kind of like squish it out and squeeze it into a long tube. That is what a jerkbait would look like. It has a lot of the same characteristics of a crankbait, of course, it being a hard plastic, not a soft plastic. It's got treble hooks, split rings, and a bill. It's basically just a crankbait, but you elongate it and work it quite a bit different. So the jerkbait that I have here, and I feel like the one that I use most often, as well as the one that I think is most affordable for you guys, is the KVD. I think this is the HC200 or J200. I'll have it linked below in the description with all, of course, all the gear that I talk about as I do in every single video. And so most of the time, I'm gonna be throwing this jerkbait right here. It dives to about 3 to 5 feet, depending on the line size you have. It dives to 5 feet for me because I throw on all my jerkbait combos, 10 pound fluorocarbon line. This is 10 pound Seaguar Abrasex fluorocarbon. And of course I'll talk about the rod and reel and gear ratio here in a second. But with most jerkbaits, they either have two hooks like this one has right here, or they have three hooks like all of these jerkbaits have right here. And these two jerkbaits here are almost the same size. One is about, I don't know, half an inch longer than the other. And so this one doesn't really dive any deeper than this one does. It's just quite a bit heavier, of course, can cast farther, and has three hooks instead of two. So while this is a relatively shallow diving jerkbait, this is a deeper diving jerkbait. This is the, I think, the HC 300 or 400 size, and this dives to about 8 to 9 feet of water. And of course, I'll explain where each of these has its best application here in a second. But in any sort of pond or lake I'm usually throwing, especially in the pre-spawn time after the winter. This is more of a winter lure. In the pre-spawn, I'm usually throwing this size right here to dive about 5 feet deep. Now, there are so many different colors of jerkbaits out there, but I have found it relatively simple. You keep it shad based. So I don't care if it's got a dot on it. I don't care if it's got, you know, sparkles or gills or some kind of flake on it. If it looks like some kind of bait fish, I feel like unless you're in super clear water, you don't have to match the hatch. You don't have to exactly mimic what those bass are eating that closely, as long as it resembles some kind of bait fish. So this one here, it's got mostly clear with a little bit of a blue and a little bit of a yellow stripe with some brown on the top. Looks like some kind of minnow that we have here in Texas. But one other color, especially in slightly dingier water and really for smallmouth bass, is going to be this color right here. I don't exactly know the name of it. I'll have it linked below, but it has a chartreuse underbelly with usually a purple top and a clear side. And this just has incredible power to catch fish in dirty water as well as smallmouth in super clear water. They just can't get enough of that color. But like I said, most of the time you're imitating bait fish. Unless the bass are just confused, you are imitating a bait fish. Now we're gonna get to casting and retrieving the lure here in a second, and of course some fish catches at the end of the video. The important thing with this is that you don't throw it on too long of a rod. Now could you say to me, Tyler, I'm gonna throw it on a longer rod because I feel like it. You can tell me that, and you know what? Go for it, knock the lights out. But in my experience, I think a shorter rod is better for a jerkbait because, as I'll explain in a second, it is better for making sure you have the angle of your rod tip when you're jerking perfect. So I have the Lewis TP1 Black Speed Stick Jerkbait Special. It is a 6'8" medium action rod with a moderate fast, medium power, moderate fast action on the tip. And I've just found this rod to be incredibly accurate casting. If I'm casting the jerkbait around shallow stumps, that kind of thing. But of course, it's not very long of a rod, and so I have an easier time in jerking it down from, as I'll talk about in a second, kind of the 8 o'clock to 7 o'clock position. But it's not too long of a rod, and so I have an easier time at effectively working the jerkbait back to the boat or back to the bank. The reel that I throw a jerkbait on is my favorite jerkbait reel. It is the Lewis Custom Light. Definitely not a cheap reel. I think it is a $280 reel, but it is a relatively shallower spool, and it is meant to throw light lures like a weightless soft plastic, a weightless fluke, and of course, a hard jerkbait like this one here. A cheaper version of a really good jerkbait reel would actually be this one right here. This is the new KVD, Kevin Van Dam series of reels. I think it's $139, and it casts like a dream. I can cast a feather a stinking mile with this thing. And if a $140 reel is still not in the budget for you, you can throw it on a regular Lewis Classic Pro speed spool, you know, $60-$59 reel. I just found that with a jerkbait especially, you want to have a really, really good reel. That way you are eliminating every backlash you can, and you have the smoothest reel possible because it's a light lure and you want to make the best cast possible. So I think I've covered everything when it comes to talking about what a jerkbait is. Of course, you want to see some fish catches and show how I retrieve this thing. So let's hop on the front deck, talk about that real quick, and we'll get to some fish catches. So when it comes to the retrieval of a hard plastic jerkbait, it's really not that difficult of a concept. It is a jerk pause, but there are a few things that you must do both pre-cast and during your retrieve perfectly in order to make sure this jerkbait is having the maximum fish catching potential. So let me show you what I mean. Now, like I mentioned, a jerkbait is a relatively light lure, at least this one here with two hooks and a relatively short bill. I mean, it can't be more than half an ounce maybe. I think it's more like 3/8 ounce. And so it's hard to throw this on a bait caster. A lot of people, like I mentioned, prefer to throw a jerkbait, especially one of this size, on a spinning rod. But based on the amount of control I like to have over my casting accuracy, distance, and of course, my control over the fish when I have it hooked, here in Texas, we got big fish. I'm gonna throw almost all my jerkbaits on a bait caster. And this is the combo that I talked about a second ago. So the first thing is the cast. The cast is very, very important because the longer your bait is going to be in that strike zone. If you make a super short cast, your bait might dive down to whatever it is, 4 or 5 feet, however deep this dives, be there for 5 to 10 jerks, and then as soon as you get it closer to the bank or closer to the boat, it starts rising back up to the surface. And so you want to make a long cast. Now, how do you make a long cast? A lot of people out there that throw bait casters use an overhand casting technique. That's basically the first one that you learn if you're a bait caster user. And I'm not gonna say you can't do that with a jerkbait. I've just found that overhand casts, especially in windy conditions, don't allow you as much control on how fast your line is coming off of your spool. And so I prefer, instead of an overhand cast like this, especially in any windy conditions, I prefer to do a full body roll cast like this. That way you keep your bait relatively lower to the water, not low enough where of course you're skipping it like a jig under a dock, but a roll cast just high enough where the wind is not really affecting the lure and it can fly as far and as straight as possible. Even a slightly more overhanded roll cast like this is going to be a lot more effective, I feel, at keeping backlashes away and being the most accurate and far casting as possible. So now that you have your cast out there, do you just start jerking away like this? No. Good question, you don't start doing that. The first step in order to get your jerkbait down to the maximum depth it can, on the box of every jerkbait says how deep they can go. Like I mentioned, that's mostly variant around your line type and your line size, but 10 pound fluorocarbon basically gets the jerkbaits to exactly what the box says they should go. And so if you're just gonna start jerking right away, you're not gonna get the jerkbait down to where it needs to be. The first step is to reel, I don't know, five, six, seven, eight times, that gets the jerkbait almost down like a crankbait, almost down to its maximum depth, and then you start jerking after that. But the Jerky J requires a specific jerking technique with your hand and of course with your rod and reel, and let me explain that. So let me show you guys kind of a full cycle of the jerkbait. So I'm gonna make a long cast out there, going to, like I said, reel five or six times. Occasionally I'll stick my rod tip in the water a little bit to get that jerkbait a little bit deeper. And once I feel like it's at maximum depth, like I said, six or seven or eight cranks, I'm gonna start the jerking process. Now this is the most important part of retrieving a jerkbait, and that is making sure that you have your rod angle right and your slack right. And so what I mean by those two things is that you want to have your rod angled down. So if you were looking at a clock, it's going to be right about 7 or 8 o'clock on the angle of a clock. And you're going to go from that angle all the way down to, I guess it'd be 8 o'clock to 7 or kind of 8 to 6:30 is how you want to jerk your rod tip. You don't want to start up here and go from, 9 o'clock all the way down to 5 o'clock. It's really just a short little staccato, 8 to 7, 8 to 6:30. But you could do the angle right and completely mess up the retrieve because you don't have the slack right. Now, why the heck do you need slack in your retrieve? Well, the important thing about a jerkbait is that you want to keep it in that strike zone as long as possible. And so if you are jerking on a completely taut line, you're pulling that jerkbait farther along on the x-axis, I could say, through the water, faster through the water than it needs to. You could have a more effective cast and keep that jerkbait in the strike zone longer if you had a little bit of slack in your line, but just enough so that when you go from that 8 o'clock to that 7 or 6:30, right when your rod gets down to that angle right there, that's when your slack catches up and you no longer have any slack in your line. So you wanna have a little bit of slack. Hopefully you can see in my chest mount here, jerk, and then you want to return your rod tip right back to where it was. So jerk, jerk, again, right back to where it was. We're kind of drifting right now, but the slack is there. Pull the slack out, and then of course, after you jerk once or twice, you'll have a little bit more slack, and so you can either reel in, or if you're drifting like I am, it'll take up the slack for you. So let me kind of switch angles here. Hopefully the sun angle isn't bad, but if I cast over here, I'm going to reel in. I'm going to go 1, 2, 1, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1. You can really, vary up whatever kind of speed, pattern, retrieve you want to do. That's up to the fish. Let the fish dictate how fast or slow they want that lure retrieved. Little hint for you guys, I found that it is far more frequent that a bass eats it when it's going slow than if you're jerking it really fast like this. I don't know of many situations that a bass wants to chase that hard to get it. And so it's really just a combination, like I said, of making sure you have the cast right, you get that bait down to maximum depth, and then you make sure that you're not having a taut line and jerking, because then you're, at that point, you're basically jerking a crankbait because you are pulling it through the water at such a speed. Sorry folks, my chest audio died. I was saying that you don't want to be pulling it at such a speed where it's not jerking back and forth. At that point, it's kind of like pulling back and forth, and you want that bait to have, like I mentioned, a staccato little bang, 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 back and forth, and that is what triggers those fish to bite. Now, as you'll see in these fish catches, the way that you set the hook is really just, you're jerking along, you go to jerk, and the fish is on there, and you just kind of pull up to it. There's no reason to jerk, 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 feel the bite, reel down, set the hook really hard, because you're just gonna pull the hooks out of the fish's mouth or break off on your line, which, at least in my experience, is mostly 10 pound for a jerk bait, which can break pretty dang easy. So hopefully that makes sense to you guys. You guys can throw it, like I mentioned, anywhere, over grass, over sticks, over rocks. You just have to make sure that you are throwing this lure above the structure in the water column, because fish will come up and nab it. So without further ado, let's hop on the water and catch some dang fish. No way. No way. I was reeling in to get back to that school and I got one. No way. That was crazy. I saw a fish, I saw a school of fish on live scope, and I burned my lipless crankbait in to get to that school, and a fish from that school came up and ate it. Oh, they're still down there. Oh, that's crazy. Yes. Oh man. All right, we're gonna get this fish off real quick. And because it's schooling bass per se, like they're not like on top, but they are schooling, I'm gonna get the fish back in the water and make another cast. There's one, there's one. I live scoped him. Live scoped him on the jerkbait. That was so cool. That was so cool. Is he big? I don't think he's small. Yeah, he's not bad. Oh, that was so cool. Only got one little hook in him though. So we're gonna net this guy. I'll tell you guys what I did here in a second after I land this fish. Ha 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 ha. That was so cool, guys. Not a big one, 3-pounder or so, really fat, but I saw him and a few other fish down there in this ditch, as I'll show you guys on the screen here. And they wouldn't bite a lipless crankbait, they wouldn't bite the Alabama rig, and so I threw the jerkbait down there and was able to watch my jerkbait move, 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 and every single movement, fish would get closer and closer, and finally two of them converged, which usually means they're competitive, so one of them is gonna eat it. And guys, as you can see, look at how thick that fish is. Wow. That's a thick fish. Good grief, I wanna weigh that thing. It's probably not 3 pounds, but it's a healthy, healthy fish. Yeah, fish weighs 2.48, a 2.5-pounder. And this thing isn't more than like 14 inches. That's unbelievable. I love that. Wow. We're gonna get a selfie and let this baby go. And I should get back in the water. What am I doing? There's probably fish that are biting. Oh, we're about to catch one. We're about to catch one. We are about to catch one. There's no way we don't. There's no way we don't. There we go. I knew it. I knew it. Oh my gosh. 3-pounder. I watched him the whole time. Oh, oh gosh. Hello, buddy. Hello. 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 Jerkbait's getting him in this ditch right here. Ah, oh, where that lipless crankbait won't, the jerkbait sometimes will. Yay! That one is not near as chunky as the last one. But still a heck of a lot of fun. Thank you, friend. There he is. Ha ha, one followed it for a while. So they're still in here. I'm not sure if there's any big ones though, because usually the biggest school, the biggest fish out of the school bites first. And I've caught like two to three pounders. So not sure where the big ones are. These are fun though. I really had to jerk it and then pause. Wait 5-6 seconds, jerk it again, and I saw him get a little bit closer. Which shows me that these fish in this school are calming down a little bit. They're not quite as angry at it as they were, you know? Thank you, buddy, you're still fun. Skerploosh. Oh, we got a pack of fish right now. Oh, we got a pack of fish. Absolute pack of them. There he is, got him, haha. Little guy, little guy. Switched up colors and got a tiny guy. He was definitely the smallest out of that entire pack. So we're going to unhook him, throw him over there, so maybe he won't go straight back to the school, and we'll make the identical cast right there. There he is. Aha, finally. Finally got one. Man, that took a while. Took me like 6 casts to get these fish to even get interested in eating, which is so interesting, because without live scope, I might have made 1 or 2 little casts over that area and then said, you know what, there's probably no fish here. But a little ditch like that, a little drain, whatever you want to call it, they hold fish. So especially in the springtime when those fish are feeding up, and if you're watching this in the summer when fish are schooling up, look at that guy, he's got a cool black spot on his tail. It's so worth it to make multiple casts in an area. It's crazy how much electronics show us that. I don't have to wonder anymore if there's fish down there. They're right there. That's so cool. Got him, got him. Digging, digging, digging on the jerkbait. Oh yes, there we go. Oh, finally. Was able to see a fish, cast to him about 8 or 9 times, and she got it. Oh, not a big one. That's weird. It felt huge and it's fighting really, really hard. Oh man. Oh wee. That is so cool, y'all. Let me spot lock us here. See if I can boat flip this guy. Oh, not a big one, but also not a bad one. Just a chunky pre-spawn fish. They weigh so much in the pre-spawn, and that is so cool. That, again, like I mentioned, I made 8 or 9 casts in that area before that fish decided to come up and smoke it. And of course, electronics helps, but you do not need electronics like I have to catch fish like this on a jerkbait. So thank you guys so much for watching this video. I hope that you enjoyed it. If you did, hit that subscribe button, because on this channel, we are all about learning how to catch more fish. And I hope that you guys today learned how to more effectively fish a jerkbait. And if I didn't, I have failed at my job. And so please leave a comment below if I missed anything out and if you guys have any more questions. But without further ado, I'm gonna go catch some more fish. See you guys next time.